it's very disturbing. So I don't think I have to tell anybody here, because most everybody that's made the trip here tonight is very familiar with the story, but there is no happy ending. I was shocked as anyone by the revelations that you're going to see tonight by the Brooks family. I didn't trick them. I didn't do anything other than just go and put a camera in their face and ask, why did you do what you did? And some of the things that they say are pretty disturbing. I want to say some thank yous. My mom and dad are here tonight. You can first go off to film school. You always dream of thanking your parents at the Oscars. Not quite at the Oscars, but... and I also still owe money on the camera, so I should have put them in as producers. My wife, Brenda, she knew, because I have some background having worked on true crime stories when I worked at Fox in Los Angeles, she thought I could do this. I went to her when I found out what the story was all about. I was starting to find out what it was all about. And she and I discussed whether I could do this. And she said, not only could you do it, you should do it. And it wouldn't exist without her support and pushing me along. And she, like all these people in purple shirts, feels deeply for what happened to Vera, and would like to see more justice come for her. All the people that appeared in the film, there's a long list of them, and many are here tonight. The film, they are the stars of the film. I wanted to speak about the structure of the film real quickly, too, because that's another thing in the test screenings. A couple people commented, well, it's 48 hours they do this, and on 60 Minutes they do this. And in that type of documentary presentation, you usually have a presenter that's sort of a buffer between you and the story. They are there, they write a script, and then they come up with some clips to support the script, and then they have Scott Pelley or Diane Sawyer or somebody appearing on screen to sort of spoon feed the story to you. What I ran into was, my thought was, I came into this right when the legal action was happening with Bixler and Peters, and I said, I'm just gonna, I didn't have time to go out and get a film grant from WBGU or any of that, because I knew this story was happening at the moment. This is of the moment, and so I was gonna get as many interviews as I possibly could while people were talking, because I knew that moment would end and then they would all kind of clam up. So the benefit of the film that you're going to see tonight is that it was all on people's minds and they were, willing to talk. And I don't think some of these people would say the same things today on camera that they did at that moment. But there was a real, urgency, because some of them didn't know whether they were still going to be charged or that. Or in the case of Daniel Bixler, who I interviewed four times now. I don't have everything on tape of my interviews with him, but I did confirm a lot of what happened with him, and he gave me the questions to go ask others by answering my questions. And I do have some audio of him in the film. I think of all the people involved, ironically, he was probably the most honest, because the audio you hear of him was the week he had just found out he was going away for life. And so he's kind of like, doesn't have anything else to lose. I might as well tell you. So you'll see that. Also, I want to thank Lynn Archbold and the festival. What a great venue. I couldn't have dreamed of a better way to launch this thing. This is the first time it's been shown to an audience, and other than the test audience, and their support. I spent all summer trying to set up screenings, and I would send the trailer to the people, I won't say who they are, but they're in Findlay. And they get the trailer, and then they wouldn't return my emails. It kind of spooked them. And I wanted to do it like a charity event for Hope House or Open Arms or something like that. And they all kind of backed away from it. I sent it here, and they jumped on it. I asked Lynn, what kind of screening we're going to get. And he said this was the unanimous choice of the judges to open the festival. And that was very gratifying. And again, thank you for all their support. There's also a line of connection to the film. Shannon Brooks and Michael Brooks, at the time I interviewed them, I don't know where they're at today, but the interviews were done here in Lima. They were living here in Lima. And also, Ohio Northern University was very supportive. the person she was, and I think it's the reason we're all here tonight. I wanted to point out something that there was all these things in the news, and it was almost like people were grasping for a reason for what the horrific crime that had happened to her. And so they were bringing up lots of things about her past and how she'd been molested and how she'd been this and that. And it was almost like she was on trial. And I just want to point out that she was innocent. Completely innocent. And there were lots of lies made up primarily by Sherry Brooks that got swirled around that she abused her own child, and she did not mean that. As you'll see in the movie, they actually accused her of killing Punky Brooks, or having a part in his death, which was one of the revelations I got from the killers. And all of these things were just fantastical lies by a fantastical liar, and her name is Sherry Brooks. And it can't be stated enough that Vera was innocent. She didn't deserve what happened to her, and I think we all know it here. And now you're going to find out what wasn't presented in the courtroom in Hancock County. You will now see her day in court, the court of public opinion. And I can't say the whole truth in 86 minutes. You're not going to get the whole truth, but this is a lot closer than what has been presented before. And there's a lot of new evidence here, a lot of revelations. I hope you enjoy the film as much as you can enjoy the film.
Thank you. two questions. One was, how did you learn this story? And the other is, how did you share it to talk to you to let others hear?
I was actually, Chip McClurkin over here has a band called Tongue and Groove, and I was at Rally the Alley in Bimini the summer that the legal proceedings were going on, and our friend and former neighbor, Libby McDonald, came up to me, and a previous documentary I had made, they made one in New York City, that had gotten written up in the Courier, and she was asking me about it, and we were talking about it, and I said, you know, I wish I could, a lot of these things that I shoot and work on, I'm always on the road, and I'd like to do something more local. She said, oh, you want a local story? She was Regal Murder, and I had heard about it, but I hadn't really paid that close attention, and she kind of turned me on to it, and then I went and met with the Voices of Rivera people. First thing they said was, we've been praying for you to come. Not that there's any pressure there, but it's like, there's something really going on here. And that's one of my frustrations with all this, too. And I give a lot of this credit for keeping the story alive to the purple peeps up here in their purple shirts. And there's kind of an arrogance in the amongst the prosecutor and the cops that they wouldn't listen to them. I mean, they can say for themselves, but I would assume some of you people that have been protesting all this time feel a little vindication from seeing this, right? That you were right. And then the cops act like you weren't. That they're going, oh, those crazy people in the purple shirts again. And I don't understand that attitude. You have people coming to you, they know the people involved better than you do, but you're just kind of blowing them off. And anyway, here we are now. Maybe something will change. So I find that relevant. you know, to have somebody to give him some of this information that he wasn't aware of. You know, and like I said, he was very stoned that whole week, and that was another thing that, that tipped me off as to what was going on. Is you look at it, people are looking for a smoking gun, like there's a videotape of Sherry Brooks handing him a suitcase full of money and saying to do it. That's not going to happen. That did not happen. But what did happen was this guy who had been over here in Allen Correctional for 3 years showed up in Tiffin, got himself in trouble there with this assault charge, and he ran, and he's hiding out. Text messages from Nicole Peters that week is she's texting her mother, who she's been having this ongoing fight with, and her old friends in Tiffin telling them that she's left the state. But in reality, they're not in the Sherry's house, so they can't tell anybody where they are. They can't, you know, they're completely beholden to Sherry, who's running the show, for their livelihood. So, of course, you're going to try and please her. And this whole thing with all the drugs, he's telling them they're doing cocaine, they're doing ecstasy. They're party. This is in vodka and Jack Daniels and all this stuff. Where are they getting the money for this party for this week? He's got none. He's got no job. He's got no. He can't tell anybody where he's at. So he can't even, if he's getting any type of check from somewhere, he can't tell where to send the check. And I asked him. I said, where are we getting the drugs? And he says, oh, Sherry's got a big ass pharmacy in Bedford. So she's feeding him drugs. And Nicole Peters, from what I was told by her son, I told her son the same thing, that she was, you know, so they're, she's got them in an altered state, she's filling their heads with these crazy stories, and that's how it happened, and that's how she got them all ginned up to do what they did.
Hello, I don't have a question to ask you, but I'd like to commend you for telling your story, because I'm Canadian, and I come and I'm touched, I feel that the story of borders touched my soul, my spirit, and I thank you for keeping her alive, because that's what I said to you now. You've kept her alive, and as long as you keep telling your story, and as long as you keep showing your film, that this would get to the world, and Vera would be kept alive, because that's what you're doing. I really agree with your wife that this is something that you need to take and run with. It is so profound. It is so strong, you know, that this is something I can take back to my children and my grandchildren. I'm so proud of my son for doing what he's doing. But tonight you have touched my soul with your story and your dedication to bringing the truth to the world, and it will. Vera will be kept alive because of you. Thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
Take the wrong person, you know, that was the biggest mistake, was
Do you think that the people that are not sharing books have remorse for their actions? Do you think that they would react in the same way if she talked them into doing something like that again?
Charges. I told him, of the police department. And so he said, well, what if I buy one? I said, sure, anybody else buy one too. So that's, you know, I anticipate that they'll, you know, they want to talk to me. But I told him, I said, I'm assuming you're going to do your own investigation, you know, because I have a pretty good roadmap that you can know when you talk to me, you know, what questions to ask. And to cut them some slack, they did get lied to.